Okay, so for those of you who just tuned in, I will just repeat again, I am Antonia and I'm a qualifications liaison manager at CIOB for London and South. So I'd like to take you to our next session where the panel and I will discuss success through degree apprenticeship and I will be talking to three panelists. So I would like to introduce those three panelists. First, we have Jordan Carr, who is 29 years old and currently works for Premier Guarantee as a building control project manager, dealing with a variety of both commercial and domestic work. His background consists of site management in the SME house building sector, warranty risk surveying, as well as working in local authority building control. Our next panelist is Emily Bowman. And Emily is a building control team leader at East Suffolk Council, working in the new home development, and is one of the degree apprenticeship panelists here today. Previously to working in building control, she worked in the new home development and prior to that in residential property valuation. She wanted to make the move to surveying and building control, so she sought a trainee role at her local authority, where she shadowed the building control team and undertook formal training. Emily enrolled on the degree apprenticeship program scheme, completing her education with gaining chartership status and CIOB. She now enjoys overseeing a wide range of projects as well as developing and training new members of the team. And my last panelist is Charlotte Almaadanli, who is a building control surveyor at Buckingham Council. Buckinghamshire. Charlotte came to this industry via unusual path, really. First studying politics and international relations and MSc in management. After the completion of the apprenticeship degree in building control surveying, she has become a member of CIOB and successfully integrated into the build industry. When she's not working, she's busy renovating her 1950s bungalow with her husband and walking their two dogs in the countryside. So kind of working again. So thank you to all three of you to agreeing to speak at our Student Festival 2023. So please allow me to welcome my panelists to the stage and we will begin with our first question. So my first question goes to Jordan. Jordan, if you could tell audience what led you to to pursuing degree apprenticeship? If you can talk us through that, please.
I guess it first started when I was working for a kind of local housing developer in North East Lincolnshire, predominantly in new house building, really. It was there that I first met the building control professional, who was a surveyor that came to site to come visit different key stages of work. And I was quite fortunate, really, that he kind of took me under his wing a bit and took extra time to explain things to me, the bits he was looking for, the reasons why I was looking for it. And he really kind of took a like to me and because of my interest in it, really. And it was, I think, maybe a few years later that he came to site one day and said that there was a trainee role coming up at the local authority. So I decided to apply for it and I was quite fortunate that I got the job. And that was in April 2017. And it was shortly after that there was the disaster at Grenfell, which really had a massive kind of impact on the construction industry as a whole, really. And it was a kind of a part of that that I decided to apply for the LABC and Wolverhampton Uni degree apprenticeship, which is part of it. You kind of get your CIOB chartership at the end if you pass your endpoint assessment.
Lovely. And obviously, you mentioned the person who encouraged you at the beginning of your sort of career journey. Do you feel you are still learning from others now? Or do you feel there is an encouragement from new colleagues to progress even further?
Well, absolutely. Every day, you still carry on learning, even in my role at the minute, even after being chartered. The construction industry as a whole is always changing. There's always new implementations to the building regs and different regulations as well. So CPD is a big part of that, is keeping up to date with all the new changes coming up.
Thank you, Jordan. I would like to ask the next question. And the next question goes to Emily. Emily, Can you tell us a little bit about how did you manage the pressure surrounding your degree apprenticeships? Any tips and recommendations you may have? So, for example, you know, work, study, life, sort of balance.
Yeah, of course. I mean, for me, I was a slightly older apprentice. I wasn't sort of green and straight out of school. So I had, two young children that were 7 and 8 when I started on the apprenticeship. Obviously, I was working full time at the council when I enrolled on it. So I was allocated one day a week for my studies, but obviously was still doing a full time workload in the rest of the time, and obviously, you know, having to do the training and study. So for me, it was managing sort of expectations at my work. So making my managers very clear of what my workload as far as the degree entailed, so that the other workload that I was getting via my employment was obviously limited. And I did have that time to concentrate on assignments and lectures, and obviously the residential training as well that we had. From my perspective at home, again, I just had to be very, you know, rigid and organised about time that I could have from home to work on my studies, but also not letting my family life and obviously my children, suffer as well. So for me, the main sort of tip I can have is just diary management, setting time aside, but really, really good communication with your colleagues and your employers, because it's very easy for them to think, oh, well, you get a day off a week to do it. But we all knew, you know, there were certain times when assignments were due, when you're doing a dissertation, that a day a week isn't enough time to concentrate on that. So for me, it was just involving them actively in the process. We had one-to-ones with the University of Wolverhampton with your mentor, which is one of your colleagues or your employees, so they could very clearly see what the workload was, and not kind of just burying your head in the sand and you know, leaving it all to the last minute, but actually being very organized and sort of scheduling time to make sure everything was done, not getting too stressed, you know, having time to do other things that you enjoy, like Charlotte said, walking the dogs or, you know, taking the kids to football or something like that to get away from it, because it can become all consuming, which isn't healthy either. So I think just, you know, trying to differentiate, set times aside, but also, you know, make sure you have enough time for yourself as well.
So yes, absolutely agreed. Communication, I suppose, with people around you is incredibly important. If you don't tell people what you're up to and what your constraints are, then, you know, it's not really realistic then. Would you do anything different, Emily, if you now had to do it again? Would you change?
I think possibly, I think with my employers, I probably could have involved them even more than I did. I probably was better at that towards the latter end of the apprenticeship, because that's obviously when I had been there longer and had better relationships with them. So I probably did spend the last sort of the first sort of 6 to 8 months just panicking, trying to do everything. So I think having those honest conversations earlier on, I mean, the three of us obviously did it at the same time, and we were the first intake on that course. So also from our perspective, we didn't have anyone that had been through that experience before. So actually now, you know, we're a few years down the line and there's new intakes every year. And I've got a colleague in my team who's 2 years behind, you know, halfway through the training. And I know what it's like. So I can kind of give them reassurance and give them help and tips. But I think at the time when we did it, it was so new, no one really knew what to expect. So, yeah, that made it probably a little bit trickier.
Thank you. Thanks, Emily. I will now move on to the next question, which goes to Charlotte. Charlotte, what, in your view, are the benefits of a degree apprenticeship qualification?
I mean, yeah, as you introduced me with, I did a traditional degree full-time in the UK straight out of school, and then from a completely different background, then got involved on this degree apprenticeship in construction. Had a politics degree previously, and being able to come from a completely different background into a new profession whilst learning and building it up with, you know, academic knowledge at the same time, it really helped reinforce well, reinforce all the stuff that we were learning at university as well, but also everything that I was seeing on site or in my day-to-day role on, you know, architectural drawings, I could then directly relay that to my learning. And then I had the whole support network around me as well. So like Emily said, you know, we have our some of our colleagues as mentors, but you also have academic mentors as well. So there's so many different routes that you can go down to seek help that when you're doing a full-time degree, you don't necessarily have that option. So it really helped me to come from no construction experience or background into this profession, and really learn as much as I could in that short period of time. But also it really helped me to maintain everything that I was learning at university. So from the degree side of it, I could then apply that, and it really does help stick if you're applying it on a day-to-day basis. I mean, another advantage is a huge one, which is financial advantage. Of course, you're working at the same time, so you have a chance to earn some money whilst you're also learning, and you don't, providing you go to, or your employer is involved in the various apprenticeship schemes, you don't have to, you know, I didn't have to pay. I have my student loan from when I did my first degree. It's a lot of money. I don't have that now. But it was a huge advantage to being able to progress and gain that academic qualification without the financial burden at the same time. It's a quick fast track, really. I did 4 years of the apprenticeship degrees from included in training, or when I first started with my employer, and to completion. Like Jordan said, we did our endpoint assessment, and that involved our chartered membership then being enrolled as part of our degree process. So I not only came out of the degree apprenticeship with a degree, I also came out of it with chartered membership. And that directly relayed into promotions at work. So I was given my own area to cover as a surveyor. And I wouldn't have had that opportunity had I not have gained that chartered membership as well as the degree apprenticeship.
Lovely, Charlotte. Thank you for answering this question for us. If I just move on to a next question, which is to Emily again. Emily, has being a chartered member enhanced your career in any shape? Obviously, Charlotte has touched on that as well, but from your point of view, from your experience.
Yeah, absolutely. There's no doubt about it that sort of underpinned all of the progression that I've had within the council and within my career. So, as I say, I started as a trainee surveyor. I did 2 CIOB diplomas initially before joining the degree, and moved from a trainee to a building surveyor. But then from then, since gaining the degree and the chartership and also joining the CIOB committee as well. So that's something else that's been really helpful in terms of kind of getting involved wider in the industry. I've then gone to a senior role and now a manager role, sort of responsible for commercial management, partnerships, and large projects. So without doing the apprenticeship, doing the full spectrum of learning that you have through that degree, but also the level of on-site, you know, hands-on experience that you get by working and training at the same time. I've got nearly 6 years experience in building control and senior, you know, large projects, but also got the theory and the qualifications behind it. So, you know, otherwise you'd be doing a degree at uni for 4 years, 3-4 years, and then you'd have to do 5 years, and that's, you know, doubling the time that it takes to be able to progress within your career. And yeah, certainly sort of with working directly with the CIOB, you get exposed to, you know, a huge amount of projects and people within the industry, getting involved in women in construction as well. All of that has come off the back of this experience in doing the apprenticeship programme.
You've mentioned being part of a CIOB committee as a member. Did you want to tell a little bit to the audience as to what sort of things you get up to, what sort of things you get involved in that
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's fantastic because they're regional hubs, so it focuses on what projects, you know, construction related projects are going in within your vicinity. So I'm in the Norwich hub committee, and that covers obviously all of the Norwich and East Anglia area down to Ipswich. We've done things like Norwich Castle, so visiting there where there's huge commercial construction projects going on there at the moment, the large NHS site at Great Yarmouth, Lakenheath Airfield. We've also run CPDs, so I've personally hosted CPDs towards the end of last year to members on the building regs changes, the sort of Part F, Part L and other changes that came in last year. I've met loads of people within the industry. I mean, even just yesterday we had a committee meeting where we spoke to Construction Area, who I know CIOB are directly involved with, which are a fantastic not-for-profit organisation that give another version of hands-on experience on large engineering projects. And these are things that I wouldn't be aware of without having that involvement. And also then being able to go out to schools and colleges and promote construction careers, you know, there's a massive skills gap. So being able to go out and promote all the positive sides of getting a career in construction, and also encouraging females into it, you know, while it's still very, very underrepresented within the construction industry, is all thanks to being involved in that.
That's excellent. I can see that you have got quite an engagement in this industry. I have another question, which is for Jordan. Jordan, were there opportunities for you to progress in your career within your company as a result of your enhanced professional development?
Yeah, similar to what Charlotte and Emily said, really. I think having the degree and the traineeship background opens up so many doors and opportunities within the industry, whether that's where you are at the moment in local authority building control, or like me, I kind of jumped across to the dark side and went to a group inspector. But I think all three of us quickly jump from like kind of a trainee or assistant role to a full surveyor role because of the degree. And I think being where I am now, my local authority beforehand didn't have many big or commercial works in the area. The kind of area is quite low rise, there's not a lot of exciting jobs going on. So that's why I made the jump to an approved inspector to kind of broaden my area really and get involved in some more complex and interesting jobs, like under the supervision of my colleagues and bits. I think going forward, especially with the building safety regulator, they're introducing kind of levels now, so you can kind of be qualified to certain levels of work. So whether that's kind of domestic work, low rise or high risk and high rise. And I think that's where having the degree apprenticeship and chartership as well will help kind of prove our competencies going forward. And that comes into play hopefully later this year.
Thank you, Jordan. So you've mentioned, obviously, from you've progressed in your career, sort of from site manager to project manager to chartership, and obviously that opened up your opportunities. Did you want to talk us through that a bit more?
I think from having a kind of site background, that gave me a bit of a different insight into how building regs work, because I've had a lot of experience on seeing it in real life and knowing how it should be implemented, because sometimes you can get designs from, say, people like architects that don't work very well in principle, and you have to try and do it on site. So I think having that kind of construction background helped me with my coursework, especially because I knew how things would work in principle. And I think a lot of many people in the course had a trade background or construction background. A lot of it was more educational, I think. So in that kind of terms, it helped me massively, yeah.
Thank you. I do have another question, a last question, and that goes to Charlotte. Charlotte, what advice or interesting facts from your experience do you have for the young people, you know, who are listening to us today?
I'd definitely say to seek out a career. If you know what you want to do, you know what you're interested in, seek out a career path where your training is all it's all rolled into one. If you can find an employer that offers an apprenticeship scheme, it's a fantastic way of getting into an industry and fast tracking yourself into the place where you want to be. There's loads of different resources. I mean, in the UK, there's a government apprenticeship website which has all of the apprenticeships listed, and there's a huge array of different, construction related, but also in different industries. But obviously construction related for this case, but different apprenticeship schemes that you can go through, where you, again, you have that advantage of not having the financial burden of funding your own training, but you also have the career advancement opportunities as well. And the other thing really would be to seek out networking opportunities where you can. It's a great industry in that you meet so many different key stakeholders every single day, but you can also expand that by, you know, there's LinkedIn, but also the CIOB portal is quite a good place to go to. But being able to then connect with different people within the industry. I mean, Emily and Jordan and myself, we all started about 4 years ago now. But I feel that if anything happened, I could definitely, you know, which was linked to where they're based in the UK or any construction products that I feel they may be interested in or be working on, I would be comfortable to reach out to them, you know. And I think that that's quite building that strong network in the degree of apprenticeship, but within the industry, really helps back yourself up, especially if you work in a small firm or you have a small team around you where you have a lot of knowledge around you, but maybe you just seek a bit more. You're able to reach out and find those answers. But I mean, it's a great career path to choose, so I definitely recommend seeking out any apprenticeship schemes, particularly, or training schemes that can be offered for you.
And obviously you have already mentioned that there is an advantage of seeking out those schemes via employer as well, to look at some employment websites, that obviously that will help you also with the cost.
Absolutely.
Getting through. Thank you, all of you, very much for all your contributions. I'm sure we have some questions, if you're ready for some to be answered. So I have a question there from Albert. He's asking, how did you find the EPA plan checks in comparison with PAN checks carried out day to day in the job? Would anyone like to answer that?
Yeah, I'll take that. I think obviously it's a bit like how you take your driving test over how you drive every day. So the EPA plan checks, you're going to the absolute nth degree in black and white on everything, very much within the way that our team runs. When we are doing plan checks on a day to day, we like to communicate actively with the architects and designers to get things resolved, rather than, you know, actually having to provide sort of a 10-page letter or list of things. We'll work with the designers, give advice and get those plans right. Whereas certainly I think with the EPA, you know, it's a much more time consuming process, but you have to get everything absolutely right to the letter, including all of the legislation and all of the part of the guidance that you're referring to. But like I say, that sets you up so well for the future, because you've then got that basis for that knowledge. But when you're doing it, it seems maybe almost too much, but it does set you in good stead for the future, because then obviously that's the basis that you need to then do the more professional communications and conversations that you have on a day-to-day basis when you're actually in a role and out on site. But yeah, it was that was a busy period doing that EPA.
Would any of you like to add anything to it from your experience?
No, I think it was echoing what Emily said, really. It was it's like, say, you try your best on it. It's the same as when you do your driving test. You can mess up on things that you would do in normal day-to-day life. And it's just a case of trying to remain composed and just do what you would do in your normal day job.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely agree with all those points. And like Emily said, there's a role of communication with all our agents, with all our partners. It's building control as a commercial entity, in that we do compete local authority and, you know, private sector, so maintaining those relationships is really key as well. So I think we definitely, phone calls as well is something that I use day to day when it comes to plan checks, because I have quite a good working relationship with a lot of our partners and agents. But with the endpoint assessment, is very much a case of list everything you've got and just try and make get the complete answer down, really.
Lovely. I hope that answered Albert's question. I do have And he does say thank you. It was useful. I do have another question here from Roz. How has the Build Safety Act changed the building control role for you, or what, how do you feel it's changed?
Sorry, I'll jump in first. I think for us, really, it's more a case of proving our competence. And like I said earlier, it would be a case of each surveyor getting kind of like a level assigned to them from whether that's testing. I think it's still a bit up in the air at the moment how they're going to prove that. But you'll only be, kind of be able to carry out work to meet the level that you've proved competent in. And with the Building Safety Act, it'd just be a case of proving that competence to do these high risk, high rise jobs, and make sure you get the kind of golden thread of information passing through from kind of inception right through to completion on the project.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, like Jordan said previously, we are in a really good position in that we were the first ones to go through this, you know, degree apprenticeship progress process for building control specifically. And because we've done our endpoint assessments, we've got experience of logging all our competencies already. So it's something that we have ready for taking the validation exams, which I think is now October till April. By April next year, I think we have to be registered by. But it's definitely slowly creeping in the, I think, to more of the senior surveyors or people who have been in the industry for a very long time who haven't had to do any competency demonstration, extremely competent, but haven't had to do the kind of written, proven way of demonstrating it, which I think will have the largest impact. So we're yet to see that trickle in, but I think it's coming.
Yeah, and I think also one of the issues that we've had is the retrospective projects. So usually building control only applies to new buildings and refurbishments and changes, whereas actually with having to go back retrospectively and make improvements to existing buildings, obviously the workload across the country is hugely increased. And so that's really shone a light on recruiting people into building control.
Well, thank you. We have a couple of minutes really left. I'm just going to check if there are any questions from the audience for you. If you have any questions, please do put them in the chat. Yes, I do have one more question, please. As someone who wishes to start his hair construction company, what are the most significant attributes that you must have? Anyone like to have a go at this?
I think it depends a bit. I think it's a case of making sure you've kind of got your knowledge up to date first and aware of all the pitfalls. And it depends what kind of construction company it is. It's quite vague. It's what kind of industry is, different parts of construction, really. But make sure you have the right information before you go in there, maybe passing on some, getting some experience from other people or knowledge from other people that have already done it already to pass on their feedback. I'm not sure if anyone's got any ideas for that one.
Anyone else wants to add to those attributes that you should have, must have?
A good relationship with building control, I'd say.
Yeah. I guess that will probably bring us to the end of our session. I just want to thank you, really, to all of you again for agreeing to speak at our CIOB Student Festival 2023. And I hope all of you audience have enjoyed this panel and got some tips and inspiration from our panelists. Good news is that there will now be a break again, and we shall reconvene again at 14:15. So please stay tuned in. I'll see you shortly.
Cheers. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you to our panel.